And one thing that I've learned, and it's kind of relevant for this talk, that's why I'm telling you this story here, is traditional ecological knowledge is more like an epistemological framework. And it's not so much about the content, but it's about how we should go and acquire knowledge and what to do with that knowledge as we live, as we experience, as we pay attention to different relationships between people, between us and the land and other living beings. And one thing that I thought was kind of remarkable from traditional ecological knowledge is that it's, unlike what might people, what I've thought, is very anti-dogmatic. There's always this idea that we ought to revise our beliefs as we go in the world and see the world changing and see the people changing as well. And so I thought that was kind of really refreshing. And I think students really appreciated that during their course. And so, and that's the connection I think that there is with the work that we're gonna hear about today by Eva Jablonka, where I think that she brings this kind of refreshing anti-dogmatic perspective on the theory of evolution. And so she's gonna tell us about that. But first, maybe let me give you a bit more detail about who she is. So she's, as I said, a professor. She is actually at the Cohn University, Cohn Institute for the History of Philosophy of Science at Tel Aviv University. She works in biology. She's been focusing on inheritance. She's been writing about epigenetics, evolutionary biology, behavioral ecology. There's kind of an interesting historical perspective as well in her work, philosophical and historical. So I find her work actually fascinating. And I was really happy that she actually accepted to come. Well, she can't come now, she's abroad. But originally she was supposed to be here with us, maybe another day, let's hope. And I've been using her writing in teaching philosophy of biology in the past, and every time it has a profound effect on students. So I'm very pleased here to introduce you Eva Jablonka. And so the title of her talk is Inheritance Systems and the Extended Synthesis. And she also, so which she published, so the she published a book recently with Lam and at the Cambridge University Press. And so the book has the same title here. So Eva, the floor is yours.
Yeah, I just share my slides, okay?
Yes, yeah, please.
Can I? So.
Hopefully you can, yes.
Yes, so you have, I think you have to allow me.
Okay.
To share it somewhere.
Let me see. Deborah, can you help us here? Deborah is working in the background here too.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to talk to you about a very recent book that I wrote with Marion Lamb in a series of books about philosophy and biology and philosophy. And in this book, what we are trying to say is that it is high time for the kind of evolutionary theory that was dominant during the last 70 years or so to be quite extensively revised. We need, so we argue, an extended evolutionary synthesis. And we're not alone in thinking that. There is a small but growing minority of scientists and philosophers of biology who share our views. So I will introduce the reasoning that is behind this, behind our position. I will introduce the kind of opposition to it, which is of course natural. Whenever you are suggesting that some big change is due, there are people who say no, it is not. And they sometimes have arguments that are good, and certainly arguments that you have to face. And then I will try to understand what kind of change is it that we're needing. Is it a kind of gestalt switch, like the one that you see here? Or is it something that includes a gestalt, or is it just an extension of what we already have which is basically more of the same. Of course, every extension is different from the original, but nevertheless, it's a kind of, how shall I say it, plastic operation. The same face, but a lot better looking. We will see where it's very difficult to make a decision about that, because we're in the midst of this kind of theoretical conceptual transformation. And when you're in the midst of this kind of transformation, it's very difficult to take the necessary distance from it and to understand where we are exactly. So first of all, I want to thank Marianne Lamb, and with whom I wrote this book on which this lecture is based. And I want to thank my student colleagues, and also Anna Jeligowski, who's sitting here in the audience, who drew this little picture. The idea that there is a need for change in evolutionary thinking has been around for a very long time. In fact, there was an important conference in 1953 in the UK where Holden, J.P.S. Holden, one of the great biologists, evolutionary biologists of the 20th century, said a lot of people are feeling that we need to have a change, that the kind of synthesis that was built recently by Dobzhansky, by Meyer, by the architects of the what is called the modern synthesis, a new instar is coming. There is a metamorphosis that is on the horizon. Well, that's how he felt, but this horizon was quite far, but I think we are reaching it now. So there was an argument. So in 2014 in Nature, there was two positions were presented to people, to the readers, about about evolutionary theory. Does evolutionary theory need a rethink? And one group to which I belong, and I was on this paper too, said yes, urgently. And the other group said, no, all is well. We don't need a change. Okay. So the position of the people who said, no, all is well, we don't need a change, they endorsed the modern synthesis, this synthesis that was created during quite a long period, but it's sort of consolidated I would say 1940s, 1950s. And this modern synthesis, according to one of the architects of this synthesis, was based on the following statement. I'm reading, that's Ernst Mayr. It was in these years, 1936, 1947, that biologists of the most diverse subdivisions of evolutionary biology and from various countries accepted two major conclusions. One, that evolution is gradual, being explicatory in terms of small genetic changes and recombination, and in terms of the ordering of this genetic variation by natural selection. And two, that by introducing the population concept, by considering species as reproductively isolated aggregates of population, and by analyzing the effect of ecological factors, niche occupation, competition, adaptive radiation, on diversity and on the origin of higher taxa, one can explain all evolutionary phenomena in a manner that is consistent both with the known genetic mechanisms, Mendelian genetics and the chromosomal theory, and with the observation evident of the naturalist. Julian Huxley designated the achievement of consensus on these points as the evolutionary synthesis. That's why we call it the evolutionary synthesis, the modern evolutionary synthesis, the MS. It required, and this is very important, that naturalists abandon their belief in soft inheritance, and that the experimentalists give up typological thinking and be willing to incorporate the origin of diversity in their research program. It led to a decline in the concept of mutating pressure and its replacement by a heightened confidence in the power of natural selection, combined with a new realization of the immensity of genetic variation in natural populations. That's Mayr, 1982. This is basically the kind of text, of course, it's updated. There is updating of everything. We know a lot about the molecular basis of inheritance today, and there are all kinds of models that have been developed. A lot has been done, but the basic concepts that Mayr puts forward here is what you will find in the vast majority of the textbooks that you will read on evolutionary biology in the 21st century. Now, we are not arguing, Mariam and I are not arguing and never argued with what the modern synthesis suggested are important processes in evolution. What we argued is with what the modern synthesis excluded or marginalized. This is what we didn't argue with the fact that there is a lot of genetic variation, which is random with respect to function. Of course there is. But we did not agree with what the modern synthesis did not allow, what it excluded. Now, what is it? Non-genetic inheritance was excluded, with the exception of human culture. The gene was supposed to be the unit of heredity and the unit of evolution. No soft inheritance. Soft inheritance is defined by Meyer. He took it for Darlington, as the belief in a gradual change of the genetic hereditary material itself, either by use or disuse, or by some internal progressive tendencies, or through the direct effect of the environment. This is totally excluded. This is Lamarckian inheritance, and you have to be either an idiot or an ignoramus, or both, in order to think so. Niche construction through the cumulative construction of ecological legacies, and the importance of these legacies in evolution is recognized, but is marginalized. There is no special mechanism that operates during macroevolution. Macroevolution is very simply an extrapolation of microevolution. It's more of the same, just longer time scale, that's all. Developmental constraints and affordances are recognized, but they're marginalized. They're not very important. They just, there's so much variation. Almost everything is possible. And the patterns of evolutions are tree-like. And although there's a beginning of a recognition that there are some web-like patterns in evolution, these are marginalized. Now, importantly for us, because we are focusing on the heredity aspect, that is why it's heredity systems, that inheritance systems we are focusing on. One can think about it in many ways. Hereditary variation, according to the modern synthesis, is thought at the level of the genes. Genes are the leaders of evolution. So genetic mutations are what is driving the evolutionary process. Dobzhansky famously said that evolution is the change in gene frequencies in population. This is what it is. Natural selection, according to this, they are beginning to recognize things like drift and stuff like this, but natural selection is the only direction-giving process in evolution. This is very, very important for Meyer, and he repeats it several times. So this excluded aspect of the modern synthesis are exactly the aspects that are very, very important for people who are pushing for a rethinking of evolutionary theory today. So what do these people say? What are the main points to which we will return, of course, of the advocates of the extended evolutionary synthesis? First of all, they're saying that developmental processes share with selection responsibility for the direction and rate of evolution and the origin of adaptation. So you cannot explain everything only with selection. You just cannot. Selection is absolutely necessary. It's obligatory, by the way, but it's not sufficient. Inheritance is not just genetic, but encompasses epigenetic, physiological, ecological, behavioral, and cultural processes. There are all kinds of mechanisms, all kinds of processes that lead to the inheritance of variations from one generation to the next. Not only genetic variation is inherited. All kinds of variations are inherited, and they can be independent of variation at the level of DNA. It's not that DNA is not necessary. It is that you cannot explain variation at the phenotypic level always by variation at the genotypic level. This is the point. Developmental systems often facilitate integrated functional responses to mutation or environmental induction. So when you're thinking about a mutation or an environmental induction, what it does to the organism is not just a property of the particular change that you're inducing, the particular mutation or the particular environmental change. It is the response of the organism that is important. This is what shapes the kind of risk, how the phenotype is constructed. Of course, the change in the gene or in the environment is important, but what is but what shapes the phenotype is the response of the organism to this kind of change. And it can lead, for example, that many, many different changes in the environment lead to the same change in phenotype, or vice versa. That a particular change in the environment or in the gene leads to many, many different changes in phenotype. So there is some decoupling between genetic and phenotypic variation. The whole way of thinking should not be gene-centered, has been to be organism and development-centered. So you have to, this is the gestalt kind of thing. You have to start thinking from the point of view of the organism and of heritable variation. But heritable variation is not necessarily variation in just variation in DNA base sequence. And there are additional processes such as developmental bias, ecological inheritance, that can explain macroevolutionary patterns and contribute to evolvability. These are very important points, and they are all related to the importance of the phenotype-first approach to evolution and to the focus on development. It doesn't mean that other things are not important, but you start your analysis in a very different way. Now, the opposition said the following things. The opposition is a people who adhere to the modern synthesis and think that all is well. These are the all is well people. So they say, they said three things in their short article. And this is repeated many, many times in all kinds of versions before and after. First, that the modern synthesis has already incorporated most of the new findings. Nothing new. We know about niche construction. We already incorporated it. We know about developmental bias. We already incorporated it. There's nothing new. Two, that a list of this, the list of subjects that need to be incorporated in given center stage is an ad hoc list. They say, why not include, I don't know, levels of selection? Why not include drift, evolution by drift? Why not include other things? Why do you choose this ad hoc? And third point is that the data coming from the study of non-genetic inheritance, especially epigenetic, is not strong enough to warrant it. The reason I'm highlighting this is that this is what I've been doing for a very long time, was talking about this inheritance things, and because this is the big worry. This has not been incorporated. Even they say that it has not been incorporated because it doesn't, there isn't enough of it to warrant the change. And this really, and a lot of the people who are attacking the extended evolutionary synthesis are focusing on inclusive inheritance and trying to say, look, we don't really have good reasons to think that this is important in evolution. And they, and especially they focus on epigenetic inheritance. The reason they focus on epigenetic inheritance is, unlike cultural inheritance, it is very biological, as if cultural inheritance is not biological, but let's leave it for a moment. Of course it is, everything is. Okay, so before we start, and I'm going to focus on epigenetics, let me introduce a very important person. This is Conrad Hall Waddington, who invented the term. I mean, the epigenetic as a adjective was used before, but epigenetics was something that he invented. And he said, it is the branch of biology which studies the causal interactions between genes and their products with which bring the phenotype into being. Now, it's such a very general definition that it's very similar to the definition of developmental biology, almost. But what he really meant and what he was focusing on are two things. He was very interested in two phenomena which decouple genetic variation and phenotypic variation. And that is plasticity. And the second one is canalization. Plasticity is the ability of a genotype to produce many, many different phenotypes depending on the environment, on the interaction with the environment. And canalization is the ability of many, many different genotypes to create the same phenotype in spite of the variations in the genotype, and also in spite of the variation in the environment. So there is a kind of canalization of development, a buffering of development to an end state. And he was very, very interested in this phenomenon as a developmental biologist. And when he was describing epigenetics, he wanted to understand the cybernetic structure. Remember also that he was working and thinking during the cyber, during the period that people were beginning to think about cybernetics and about regulatory systems and about regulatory architecture, about attractors in physics, attractors in biology. All these things were very, very central to Waddington's thinking. So when he was talking about epigenetic, he wanted to understand this network of cybernetic interactions that create the stability and also the plasticity of the phenotype. Now, the term epigenetics, like every term, including the term genetics, has undergone many, many changes since Waddington. And when we use it now, we use it in slightly different terms. I will not go into the history of the term. It's really interesting. At some point, epigenetic inheritance and epigenetics were considered to be synonyms. All kinds of weird things happened. There was huge confusion in the literature. So one of the things I'm always doing is I'm trying to just give some definitions so we have a common ground. You may agree or disagree with my definition, it doesn't matter. As long as we know what we're talking about, that's the important thing. So in a slightly narrower sense, more focused sense, epigenetics is the study of developmental processes in prokaryotes and eukaryotes, in all organisms, that lead to persistent self-maintaining changes in the state of organism, the components of organisms, or the lineages of organisms. This is how Marin and I defined the term. An epigenetic inheritance is not a synonym of epigenetic. It is a component of epigenetic. It refers to the transmission to subsequent generations of epigenetic variation that do not stem from variation in DNA-based sequence. When I'm saying epigenetic variation, I'm talking about developmental variations. Not all developmental variations are induced. There is a lot of what people call developmental noise, random developmental variations, all kinds of stochastic things that happen during development. These are also important. But we're talking about that subset of variation, both stochastic and directed, that is heritable. Heritable either at the level of the somatic cell or of the organism in whatever way it is transmitted. So when we're thinking about epigenetic inheritance and the inheritance of variations, we may ask, well, what are the pathways of inheritance? And I want to talk about four pathways. You can inherit epigenetic variations, variations that are not, that are not explicable in terms of variations in DNA. The DNA is the same all the time, okay? Just let's freeze DNA sequence totally for the time being. Afterwards, we'll defreeze it. But at the moment, let's freeze it, okay? So you have variations in things that, in components of the gamete, these are the GC is germ cells, that are transmitted from germ cell to germ cell, like DNA. Right, like variations in DNA. You have also epigenetic variations, variations that are not variations in DNA, that can be transmitted from gamete to gamete. This is one generation where the square, the top square is generation one, the second square is generation two. Now, so this is one thing. The other thing that can happen is that variations in the germline, some variation in the germline is affecting the soma, affecting the body, the developing body. It can be of the embryo, it can be of the adult. And this then, from the body, something is transmitted to the gamete of the next generation. So the mother transmits something to the germ cells of her offspring, okay? That's another possibility. From this is soma to germline transmission. Another mode of transmission is from soma to soma. It doesn't go through the germline at all. You just transmit from soma to soma, and I will give you an example. I can give you examples of each of these things. So for example, you sort of transmit, behaviors. You can transmit, you observe my behavior, and this behavior affects the behavior of my offspring, okay? It doesn't have to go through the germline. Or I my behavior induces some change in my offspring that lead to my offspring afterwards to reconstruct this change when he or she is a parent. This is soma-to-soma transmission. And then there is, And then there is transmission through ecological legacies. So I, the adult, change the environment, and this environment affects my offspring in a way that leads them to change the environment or maintain the environment, which in a way that is in the same way. So I change the environment as a result of this. The phenotype of my offspring changes, and the change involves also that they, in their turn, reconstruct the environment. So it remains more or less the same. Of course, not exactly the same with modification. Okay, so there are four ways of transmitting variations from one generation to the next. Germline to germline transmission is not the only way, although it is a very, very interesting way, of course. And it's the way to which we are accustomed to think about. The idea that you can transmit hereditary variation from the soma to the germline was supposed to be impossible. It was one aspect of what is called the Weismann barrier, the barrier between soma and germline, no transmission of from soma to germline. We know that it can happen and it does happen today. Soma to soma germline was supposed, if it was through behavior, it was not exactly biological for some reason, and ecological misconstruction was recognized, but its importance for evolution, its importance, it's the way that it changes the evolutionary dynamics was not appreciated for very long. Okay. So as we saw, one of the major aspects that people are saying that we don't really need to change the way that we think about heredity, and therefore also the way that we think about evolution, is that non-genetic inheritance, the data that is coming from the study of non-genetic inheritance is not strong enough. And it doesn't warrant a change in evolutionary thinking, because everybody would agree that if you have, if you have all these four pathways of transmission, and if these pathways of transmission are all important, and it is possible to transmit non-genetic variation in all these ways, well, then we do have to accept that the inheritance of acquired characters is possible, or acquired variations is possible, that there are all kinds of things that can impinge on development in ways that we didn't appreciate before, and we have to start learning and studying the dynamics of this kind of changes. So this is a picture that Anna did in order to sort of tell us, to give a kind of more friendly explication of what it means to inherit all kinds of things. So yes, we can inherit inherit DNA and all kinds of epigenetic variation that are superimposed on DNA or are found in the cytoplasm or in the non-DNA bits of the sperm and the egg from one generation to the next. This is possible. But in mammals, so we inherit both DNA and non-DNA bits through the gametes. And then if we are mammals, we also get all kinds of things from the mother that affect the way that we develop, and also may affect the way that the development of our offspring is constructed. Construct the same kind of initial conditions for the next generation. And we can get all kinds of, during early development, all kinds of things can impinge on all kinds of characteristics of ours, for example, on food preferences. And the food preferences that we induce in our offspring, in turn, can induce the same food preferences in the next generation. And the whole big thing there is mother culture, which is very specific to humans. And this is called the five mothers. So the fifth mother is the mother culture, which is the way that we transmit variation in our case through symbolic culture. And symbolic, the transmission through symbolic culture, we, of course, everybody accept this, that it is very, very important. It is shaping us as human beings and so on and so forth, but it's doing all kinds of interesting things. It is also shaping our genetics, by the way. It's not just shaping our epigenetics. It's not, the cultural inheritance is not really separated in the long term from other forms of inheritance. So what has happened was that, of course, everybody knew that the early development and the all kinds of things that are transmitted through the egg and sperm and the early nutrition and early care and culture are all changing the phenotype. What was not appreciated is that these things can lead to heritable changes, to actually heritable changes. So that can be transmitted from one generation to the next. So I think the big breakthrough came not from the recognition that there is a transgenerational inheritance. This was known. This was known for ages. What we didn't know were the mechanisms. And because we didn't know the mechanism, and because it was seemed such a messy kind of in transmission, people were looking, for example, at the effects of morphine in rats, or of alcohol in rats, or of maternal care or deprivations of maternal care in all kinds of animals. And they saw transgenerational effects for one generation, for two generations, sometimes for six generations. But what to do? What do you do with it? So it was scattered in the literature. This kind of data was scattered in the literature. There was no way of thinking about it in a coherent way, or at least it was not clear how to think about it in a coherent way. And the breakthrough, I think, came in the 80s and the 90s, where people were beginning to understand the kind of mechanisms that lead to the reconstruction and or even the copying of particular states of activity from one generation to the next, both in somatic cells, cells that are not germline, so that is not gametes, but the cells of the body, and the cells of the body that do not create gametes, and gametes. So I don't think that, I don't want to go in any depth into these mechanisms because it will become very, very technical. But basically it was recognized that there are all kinds of ways of doing it. So one way is by self-sustaining metabolic loops when you have a kind of positive feedback and when the cell divides. We're thinking about a bacterium. If something is induced through the environment and there is a kind of a new feedback loop as a result is generated within the cell, when this cell divides, components of this feedback loop are transmitted to the descendants through cell division, and this reconstructs the loop even when you don't have the stimulus from the environment. The environment has changed back to the default environment, let's say. So you will have that. Then there is another mechanism which is self-reconstructing three-dimensional structures, and all kinds of prion diseases are based on this. We know certain proteins can fold in different ways, and some of the ways of folding lead to the reconstruction of the same folding when a new protein is formed. So the protein is folded, it can take this kind of shape, and it can take this kind of shape. It takes this kind of shape. Then once this shape is there, when the protein is formed, the chain of amino acids will sort of interact with this shape and will create the same shape as a result. So it's a kind of self-templating, three-dimensional process. Then we have something that is called chromatin marks, and these are all kinds of modifications of either DNA itself. The DNA itself, you add some kind of group to the DNA, for example, CH3 group, which doesn't change the coding properties of the triplet on which it was the part of the triplet on which it was added, but it does change whether or not the probability, whether or not this particular region of DNA will be expressed or not be expressed. It changes this. And this can be inherited. Now, dedicated mechanisms that can inherit it can lead to the inheritance of these patterns of performance or of dispositions to perform, to be expressed. And there are also other kinds, many kinds of chromatin marks, not necessarily on the DNA, they can be on the histones around which the DNA is wrapped. And there are also small RNAs, which can be transmitted from one cell to another. And the small RNAs, in some organisms, there is a dedicated machinery for replicating them, right? Like there is DNA polymerase for replicating DNA, there is RNA polymerase for replicating these small RNAs. So all these things have been sort of, we learned about them during the 80s and the 90s. And once people learned about them, a lot of things became much clearer. It became much clearer, for example, how cell determination happens, why certain stem cells are stem cells for skin and other stem cells are stem cells for neurons. And they don't suddenly switch their identity. Their identity is very, very stable. And the stability, the cell memory, is underlined by this mechanism. And it also became clear that all kinds of bizarre things that people were discovering when they were doing experiments with transgenes, they were introducing new genes in the 1980s, for example, 1990s, into organisms. And these genes entered into the organism and everything seemed to be well, and suddenly they didn't express themselves anymore. So people thought, why not? What happened? Did they sort of get excluded out of the genome? Were they thrown out of the genome of the accepting animal or plant or whatever organism was used? And then they discovered, no, they were not, they're still there. The DNA is still there, but now it is very heavily methylated. It is repressed, and it is repressed in such a way, in a way that is heritable. So at first people thought, well, these are just bizarre things. You know, it happens in pathological conditions. It's not really important for evolution. It's just an extreme case. So they focused on the developmental aspect, and very, very few people were thinking about the evolutionary aspect of it. It was clear, it was beginning to be clear quite soon that it's important for medicine, that some cancers may have their origin in not in genetic variation, but in epigenetic variation. That was already suggested in the 1980s. But transgenerational inheritance mediated through this kind of mechanism, it took people not a long time to think about it, because Marian and I suggested it in 1989, many years ago, to start accepting that this may be actually important in evolution took a very, very long time. So people are worried about all kinds of things. They can say, well, yes, today nobody will say that there's no epigenetic inheritance from one generation to the next, that these mechanisms do not lead to transgenerational inheritance. This is recognized. So what do you do if you are opposing the importance of these things? So you say, well, yes, but it's not very stable, or it's just special cases. Well, it is not special cases. It is ubiquitous. Epigenetic inheritance was found in every organism that was ever studied. That's it. It's just there. It's part of basic biology. It's a very, very important mechanism that is recruited also for inheritance from one generation to the next. It's not the only thing it does. It does a lot of other things, but it was found everywhere. Two, the fidelity of transmission. People say, well, the fidelity of transmission is not as high as DNA. It is variable. And it depends on the nature of the variant, the condition, and the taxa, and the group. And transmitted changes are common and are often induced by stress. So there's a lot of scope for selection at the epigenetic level. And in plants, for example, in Arabidopsis, where this question was studied in great molecular detail, it seems that the inheritance is stable enough for selection to be very, very important. And not only is it stable enough, but epigenetic changes can induce changes in very important traits, I mean heritable that are heritable, such as the length of the roots or the flowering time. And the heritability of this epigenetic variation is between 60% to 90%, which is huge. So we can ask all kinds of questions about it. So, you know, what is, if we're starting to think as evolutionary biologists about the system of epigenetic inheritance, we can ask a lot of questions. I will focus on the third question, but I'll just introduce very, very briefly the first one. What are the evolutionary origins and mechanisms behind epigenetic inheritance? How did it evolve? So the evolution of this mechanism. This is one question we can ask. Second question is we can ask, under what condition is it beneficial? Is it advantageous to have epigenetic inheritance? We can discuss these questions. There are answers to them. Answers more or less speculative to each of them, and more than one answer. The most important question for people who are doubting the importance of epigenetic inheritance of evolution is, what are the evolutionary consequences of epigenetic inheritance? Why can't we reduce them to genetic variations? So people who have been, so there's a lot of work on very, very different aspects on how the fact that you have epigenetic inheritance, the way, how can it affect evolutionary history? So it can have effects on genetic evolution. It can affect the dynamics of phenotypic change in populations. So how population change in terms of the changes in the frequency of heritable traits. We can ask how epigenetic inheritance directly contributes to adaptation. We can ask how epigenetic inheritance contributes to macroevolution. And we can ask how it affects the major evolutionary transition in evolution. Again, I cannot go into detail about each and every one of them. I just want to give you some kind of taste of what it is. So we can have, for example, there are many effects that the epigenetic inheritance can have on genetic evolution. One is on mutability. For example, when you have a chromatin mark, such as a CH3 group, it can increase mutability by 4 to 15 times. So it can change mutability of DNA and therefore sort of lead to all kinds of evolutionary change at the genetic level itself. It can have an effect on population dynamics. Here, people have been doing both studies looking at populations, semi-filled populations. These are it's not exactly in the these are plants that are genetically the same but epigenetically very different. They use the little trick in order to create this kind of plants, and they are looking at how populations can change over time and what kind of variations there are and how long these variations are inherited. And they are inherited for a very long time. There are also models, population epigenetic models, that are to some extent similar to population genetic models, but with modifications. And they are showing how a population under very realistic assumptions will change through epigenetic inheritance. And there is a whole load of such models. Then there are specific adaptations that are based on epigenetic inheritance. And I will not go into them, but they are very important because they are immunity to viruses, for example, in the small worm C. elegans is mediated by a system that is based on small RNAs. I will not go into this because it's, and then there, what we see also when we're doing hybridizations, and we know that in plants, for example, hybridization is extremely important for macroevolution, for changes at the level above the species level. We see massive, massive changes in the epigenome, in epigenetic variations, like 30, in one case it's 30%, in another case 15%. I mean, we're talking about millions and millions of sites which are epigenetically changed, and some of this is inherited between generations. It's a kind of revolution, and then it's kind of five generations of big changes in some cases. For example, in wheat, when they recreate, when they do two rounds of hybridization, and then sort of it, you sort of it's equilibrates, and then you can you have a kind of small, much slower rate of evolution. Okay, and there are all kinds of interesting things that we can do, because we have now new methods to detect epigenetic variation, even in ancient DNA. Like DNA methylation can be detected actually in ancient DNA, so we can know something about the epigenome of very ancient humans and other animals and plants. And we can begin to use this kind of new knowledge in order to reconstruct history in a more detailed way than we can do just with DNA. So, okay, we have all this very interesting stuff coming from all directions. Does it require, what kind of view is required in order to accommodate this kind of changes? And I was just talking here about epigenetic inheritance, which is, and which is common to all organisms. I was not talking about behavioral inheritance, which is specific to animals with social learning, nor was I talking here about symbolic evolution, about symbolic systems, which are specific to humans. But very, very clearly, and I can give you examples if you want, this too can lead to big changes at every level. So what do we need? Let's go back to the objections. The MS, the modern synthesis, incorporated most of the new findings. So me and my colleagues, we went to the books, to the textbooks. We looked at 10 or 15 textbooks, I don't remember. I looked at 15, I remember. I don't remember if all of them went into their paper. And it's simply not true. They are not incorporated. They are sometimes, they're given a box, or in some cases, a very short discussion, but they are not part, an important part of any of the what students are taught in the 21st century. The list of subjects that need to be incorporated given center stage is an ad hoc list. This is simply not true. All the subjects are centered on development and on the assumption that you have to start the analysis from the phenotype and from the heritable, from the heritable phenotypes, but not this is the unit that you have to focus on. The data for coming from study of non-genetic inheritance, especially epigenetics, is not strong enough, and it doesn't warrant a change. And this is simply not the case. There is a lot of data. So I want to argue that the extended evolutionary synthesis does make a change to biological thinking, to philosophical, to the way that we do philosophy of biology, and to the methodological and social aspects of biology. So what is it? Are we in the midst of a paradigm shift, a change in thought style, or what? So Fleck, Ludwig Fleck, who predated Kuhn by, I think, 20 years, 30 years, I don't know, something like that, was talking about his book is called The Generation and Construction of a Scientific Fact. A very telling kind of title. And he said, Genesis and Development of a Scientific Fact, sorry. And he suggested that during the development of science, what is happening is that a certain thought style is created. And this thought style is characterized by common feature in the problems of interest to the thought collective, by the judgment which the thought collective considers evidence, by the methods which it applies as a means of cognition. And it is accompanied by a technical and literary style characteristic of the given system of knowledge. And once this kind of thing consolidates, once it is solid, it's very, very difficult to change. because what happens is when you have challenges, all kinds of the way that people react to these challenges is a contradiction to the system appears unthinkable. So for example, the inheritance of acquired characters was seen really as impossible, mechanistically impossible. There was no evidence for it and so on. And the fact that there was evidence for it, and quite a lot of evidence for it, was completely disregarded. It was just unthinkable. What does not fit the system remains unseen. You just don't talk about it. And you think it's noise. You think, well, I didn't do the experiment right, or this experiment was probably rubbish, or something like that. Alternatively, if it is noticed, it's either it is kept secret. And we know from the history of biology that it is true. For example, there was a huge project for transgenerational inheritance in the BVA in Vienna in the beginning of the century, which lasted until the 1930s, when the Nazis deposed the Jewish scientists who established this BVA. The BVA was probably the biggest, certainly in Europe, the biggest private institute for experimental zoology in the world, maybe in the world, but for sure in Europe. There were hundreds of publications, hundreds of scientists, hundreds of species were experimented on and so on and so on. All this was very actively forgotten because in Austria, the Nazi scientists were not deposed. Nothing happened to them. They still were very, very influential in Austria after the Second World War. And they just didn't want to talk about the BVA and all this research project. And they didn't. So, and also, despite the legitimate claim of contradictory, laborious efforts are made to explain an exception in terms that do not contradict the system. We see it all the time. I mean, whenever there was some kind of transgenerational inheritance, it was described in terms of modifier genes. This was the magic word. And five, despite the legitimate claims of contradictory views, one tends to see, describe, or even illustrate those circumstances which corroborate current views and thereby give them substance. We see all these things very, very clearly with respect to the research project of transgenerational and epigenetic inheritance. I mean, one can give examples to each and every step of these things and more than one. Now, Kuhn, when he was talking about paradigm shifts, and afterwards he was in the second edition of the book, he was talking about what he called disciplinary matrix, changes in the disciplinary matrix. And I like this better than the paradigm shift, not because of that, I have nothing against paradigm shifts, but I think the disciplinary matrix gives us a kind of better feel of what of the kind of system that is involved. And what Kuhn says when he's describing it, he says that when you have a disciplinary matrix, a thought style, if we take Flex idea, it involves what he calls a symbolic generalization, which are the expressions, as he said, deployed without question or dissent by group members, which can readily be cast in logical form. Like, for example, change, and they involve either a formula or a change in definition. He gives the example of spontaneity in physics. Mara and I are giving the example of heredity in evolution, that we just change the definition of heredity. Heredity is not just DNA. So heredity and evolution, according to the EES, are redefined. The second thing that he's talking about is about the models and the metaphors. So Kuhn gives the examples of molecules of gas that are described as little rigid balls that are billiard balls that are hitting each other. In evolutionary theory, we had the little genes in populations that were the basis of the models. And the EES is changing these models. It's suggesting very, very different models, and is not using this kind of metaphor, this type of metaphorical thinking. Of course, metaphorical thinking is used, but it's different metaphors. normative values. So what is important? Which thing is worth studying at all? So it was thought that what we want to study for a long time were variations in DNA. This is worth studying. Or if you want to study heredity, this is what you study. You don't study other things. And we suggest, yes, you do. And you also study the kind of situations and the kind of systems where you have decoupling between phenotypic and genotypic variation. So you study plasticity, you study canalization. And exemplars, and when Cohn is talking about the disciplinary markets, he said when during the socialization of new students and new researchers and so on and so forth, certain things are given to them as examples. This is an example of what you want to study. So for example, for the modern synthesis, it was a sickle cell anemia was one of the examples. Another example was the change in the color of distant Betularia, the peppered moth as a result of changes in air pollution. And the EES is using very, very different exemplars in order to explain the kind of variation that they are interested in. For example, they are looking at inbred line where there's no genetic variation, like Arabidopsis or inbred mice. And using all kinds of new and more statistical analysis in order to look at the effect of epigenetic variations in populations where there is also genetic variation. So there are all kinds of things that happen during a transition when you have this transition, and all these changes can be sort of mapped into what is happening during the current period when we are trying to push for a change in the thought style of evolutionary biology. So there are three things I want to highlight. I know I don't have much time, so I'll run through them very, very quickly. One is that we have to think about phenotypes first. Our analysis starts with the phenotype and the importance of, and so you don't start with genetic variations which lead to phenotypic variation. You look at phenotypic variations which are heritable and you ask, well, how did they come about? How should we analyze them? You do not suppose in advance that you can explain them through just genetic variation. Second, you recognize that there is transgenerational recurrence of developmental variants. There is inclusive inheritance. Soft inheritance exists. You just recognize this. And third, there is non-random generation of selection regimes. So the selection regime to which an organism is subject is not something that he has no power on. It just happens to it. No, it creates them to some extent, creates the environment in which it is itself, it and its offspring are selected. And phenotypic variation is not random. Phenotypic variation is the result of the way of the developing phenotype, and the developing phenotype is in no way displaying random variation. This doesn't mean that random variation doesn't happen, but at the genetic level, there's a lot of random variation, not just, but a lot. Okay, so there are all kinds of, so all the things that were marginalized by the modern synthesis are given a very important position within the extended evolutionary synthesis. There is a developmental system approach to heredity and evolution, and it's organism-centered. The agency of the organism is very important. You can decouple under some conditions genotypic and phenotypic heritable variations. Heritable variations are not produced randomly. And inheritance is based not only on replication, on copying, but on reconstruction processes. And there are Lamarckian processes in evolution. We just have to accept this as a fact. And horizontal gene transfers, genome fusions, and gene sharing through hybridogenesis and symbiosis are far more common than we thought, and they can have very big effects on evolutionary history. And selection is very expanded. We have to think about selection within the organism, between within cells, between cells within an organism, between gametes, between organisms, between lineages. And we have to think also about selection in terms not only of multiplication and replication, but also selective stabilization, differential selective stabilization, and the way that all these things interact. And we don't have, there is no privileged level of evolutionary analysis. In some cases, it is good to start with a gene. In some, in many interesting cases, it is not. So it depends very much on the question that you are asking, where you start your analysis and how you start your analysis. I will not go into this very complicated figure because this will take an hour, but there is a way of putting it all together in a small diagram, which takes into consideration all this aspect. Now, there are lots and lots of, when we're thinking about all kinds of basic notions that we have that come from biology, all these notions are changed as a result of if we adopt the extended evolutionary synthesis. So for example, the structure of evolutionary theory is modified to some extent. The focus is on heritably varying traits and on reproducers rather than on replicators and vehicles, as suggested by somebody, people like Richard Dawkins. And the approach is systems biology approach. It is a system approach. You need to reframe the ultimate and proximate distinction. Not the distinction is still valid, but you have to think about it differently. You have to extend the notion of homology. Homology has to be defined as any trait that is inherited continuously in two different lineages from a single common ancestor, whatever its form, function, or underlying developmental and inherited mechanisms. You have to extend the notion of individuality, of biological individuality. The species concept and the phylogenetic patterns that you kind of pay attention to also undergo changes. You think about information because it is a kind of common denominator for all these types of variations. So you can think, if you want to generalize, this is the way to generalize through the concept of information. And it would be good if we could reformulate the price equation in informational terms, something that I have been thinking about for a long time and still working on it. And other people too are thinking on it. And the focus is on evolvability and plasticity. And there are the notion of learning in evolution in cells, within cell learning and organism learning and evolution as learning is beginning to be also a kind of new way of thinking about evolution when you are adopting this kind of perspective. And there are also kinds of social and methodological issues. So for example, you have to change the models. You have new models now. You have new model organisms. You have new techniques that you have to develop in order to follow the epigenetic variations in DNA from living organism and in ancient DNA. There are changes in institutions, laboratories, and influential people are beginning to change. And books, popular books and handbooks and a lot of books on epigenetic inheritance, a lot of new journals about epigenetic inheritance, and a lot of exoteric hype. I mean, a lot of rubbish is talked about it. Suddenly is the magical key to every problem that we have, just like genetics was. You can do eugenics, you can do I don't know what you can do with epigenetics, you can reframe the human being through this kind of thing. So there is all kinds of, there's very great similarity in this sense, unfortunately. So what does it mean? Does it mean that we're still in this, that we're simply extending the model synthesis? That it's a kind of plastic surgery we are doing or is it a significant revision? I think that all those examples that I gave you, both at the theoretical level of evolutionary theory itself, of the philosophy of biology, of the methodological and social aspects, suggest that it is a big change that is happening. And Marion and I think that what we're doing, that it's very difficult, of course, to judge it when you are sort of in the middle of it. But Marion and I think that the change that we're witnessing is conceptually similar to what happened in the 1960s in psychology, when the behaviorist thought style was replaced by the cognitivist thought style. Behaviorists thought about psychology in terms of relation between input, output, and reinforcement. These were the three things that could explain everything. And they black boxed intervening computational cognitive processes in the brains and neurobiology. While the cognitive focus was on the computational processes. This is what interests. And similarly, MS advocates think of evolution in terms of relation between genetic mutation, like the input, phenotypic change, output, and selection, reinforcement. And they black box development and agency, while the EES proponent focus on development and agency and see them along with selection as central to evolutionary biology. So we think that it's not happening at the same rate, it's not happening in the same way. The style is very different, which is in many ways a good thing, because the kind of belittling of behaviorism and sort of throwing it out of the window was not a good thing, in my opinion. But there was a lot that this thought style did give us. But I think that it is a rather similar, I was struck by the similarity between this parallels between in the change in psychology and the change that we're undergoing now in biology. Now, does it mean that it will change very soon? Probably not. And I will end by citing Tversky, Amos Tversky. Theories are not refuted, they are embarrassed. So, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Eva. We're all clapping in our little room here. That was fascinating. So now we're going to, we still have a bit of time for a question. So we're gonna go until 12:30. So the way we're going to do the question period, because there's a lot of you and I can't see everybody at once, we're going to use the chat here to ask questions. So if you would like to ask a question, I would like you to just open up. So there's a little kind of icon at the bottom of your screen. You should be able to open up the chat and just write H for hand to signify that you have a question, and then we can go from there. Instead of like typing the question in the chat, you can go on and ask your question. So if you have a question, then I would like to ask you, first of all, remind you this talk is recorded, so be nice. Try to have a brief question and clear question, not giving a talk in itself. I would like you to turn on your camera as well, so as you're asking the question, so that Eva can actually see you when you do so. So if you can just access the chat and put a little H there to signify that you would like to ask a question, then I'm going to try to keep track of it as much as I can. Maybe I'm going to start with one observation. It's not so much a question, but so not so long ago in the reading group that we have, we've been looking at a paper on biological embedding. So how epigenetic changes that are often induced by stress can actually affect the behavior of people on the very long term. And so that was kind of within a generation. They were not necessarily talking about epigenetic inheritance, but there was still in that paper, which was extremely recent, I think it was just 2020, a line saying that there's still no proof that epigenetic changes are inherited. Or so there was this allusion that we don't want to commit that there's any kind of evolutionary significance to these things. And I was quite surprised because I've been familiar with your work for some time. And I thought that was kind of interesting to see that they even like the even now there might still be resistance to accept the kind of extension that you're proposing.
Well, you know, it's the problem is that with humans, it's very, very, very difficult to tease apart different aspects of what's going on, and people are trying to do it. The data from humans is limited. This is true. We have a lot of data from other organisms, but in humans, the data is limited. So yes, there is an inheritance of epigenetic effects of stress. I mean, for example, the famous starvation study by Barker, right? When the Dutch people were starved by the Nazis,
yeah,
in Amsterdam, yeah. And as a result of that, they really lived on something like 600 calories a day, and that led to women who were, I think, in the third semester of their pregnancy to give birth to babies that had a lot of problems, all kinds of problems. They were smaller, but not only smaller, they are all, because they caught up in terms of weight, but they had all kinds of other problems like diabetes and coronary diseases and schizophrenia. You name it, you have it. When they grew up compared to their brothers or sisters that were born either before or after the starvation period. And that was a big, big cohort, unfortunately, of kids, and big cohort of control kids as well. So that there's no question about it, but one can argue, and rightly so in a way, that this is not an inherited effect. This is an effect directly on the offspring, on the child through the mother, through the stress. It is stressed itself. To show the effect on what about the next generation? On the next generation, we have very little evidence for epigenetic inheritance there. There is some evidence for that, but not very much. So it's going down, thankfully. In some cases, it's really not very long-term, this inheritance. In some cases, it seems from animal models that it is. But again, humans are very long, life cycle, very, very plastic, incredibly plastic. We're thankfully incredibly plastic species. So if they were referring just to human studies, I would, there are all kinds of studies. A lot of them are not very good statistically. They are very suggestive. And I think they're right, but the sample is not big enough. Yeah, if they're talking about it, they're right. There isn't very good evidence. But in other animals, there is very good evidence and very convincing evidence. So.
Yeah, thanks for that clarification. Yeah, and possibly they were actually thinking, yeah, more in the context of human studies, but
yeah,
they were citing all kinds of studies with animal models as well. So anyway, so we do have at least a couple of questions in the chat here. So the first one from Derek Oswick. So Derek, if you could turn on your camera and.
Hello, Dr. Jablonka. Thank you very much for a wonderful talk. I wanted to get your impression on sort of where you see this most recent proposal from you as being part of a longer conversation, because your the way that your interlocutors were kind of responding seemed to me very analogous to some of the frustrations that Oyama had experienced when she was talking about trying to convince everyone that we needed to be interactionists about development and evolution, where people responded with, well, we're all interactionists, so what's the big deal? And your interlocutors are saying something like, well, we admit that, you know, niche construction exists. We admit that epigenetics exists. It's because we admit it exists, therefore it's somehow accounted for and part of the picture. We don't need to make any further changes. So do you see what you're proposing as being sort of a new aspect of a much longer discussion between a more reductionistic interactionism versus a more holistic interactionism, or how do you sort of see this fitting in with the history of that type of conversation?
Yes, you know, there is an interesting book that was written recently by Peterson. he was talking about the theoretical biology club that was created in the 1930s by Waddington, Woodger, Needham, and a group of people that they called themselves the theoretical biology club. And what they were trying to do, they were trying to form a systems biology kind of way of thinking. They had some of the most intelligent people, I think, certainly in England, in the UK there. And they thought very, and then, you know, the Second World War happened and everything sort of fell apart. But they were thinking very much in the terms of what is happening now. So there is a nice quotation, I'll cite it to you, by Lenin. Where is it? It's, yes, he said the development, that Lenin said that the evolution of science is, this is a development that repeats, as it were, the stages already passed, but repeats them in a different way on a higher plane. A development, so to speak, in spirals, not in a straight line. And I had very much the feeling that's how Marian and I started our thing, because we were sort of thinking, just as you said, you know, we're coming back to something, but on a very different level. So it's like, yes, we sort of go there, there's a parallelism there, but it's a different level. And the different level is not because we're wiser than these people, but simply because there was a lot happening in science. And a lot of the people who were very, very dominant and very, sometimes very constraining, very, very dominant in good ways and in bad ways, are no longer there. So there is more freedom of thought also, but also there is simply a lot more data. So it is not the case, by the way, as you said, that people say, well, we know about epigenetic inheritance. They said that, no, there is, the evidence is not good, but the evidence is good. And it was good for a very long time. This is what's so interesting, not for epigenetic inheritance, not at the molecular level, but at the descriptive level phenomenon, kind of, yes, that this kind of phenomenon exists. It was there. It was just scattered terribly in the literature. And it was ignored by the people who, by those people, by the architects of the modern synthesis. It was simply ignored. And partly because, you know, they were looking at different things and they were using different methodologies. I'm not blaming them in any sense, in any way. I don't think it was done because they were choosing animals, for example, where they were, first of all, trying to get rid of all the effects of plasticity. This is exactly what they were trying to do. So when you try to get rid of that, you don't have it, obviously, right? So, you know, so the methodologies were different. The objectives were different. And what was worth exploring and what was not worth exploring was different. So yes, I think that we are very much, and there were a lot, not only Oyama, other people too. I mean, you know, there was Hohen Sanders. There were all kinds of people who were all the time pushing, and the Holden himself had this very, very nice 1953, he was talking about the new insta that is coming upon us of new evolutionary thinking. Well, it took 70 years for it to arrive, but the new insta, but it took a long time and a lot of opposition too. I mean, really, I mean, I was very young, when I started talking about epigenetic inheritance. I did my PhD on DNA methylation in cell lines. That's how I came to this. I'm a geneticist and did evolutionary biology stuff on this. So anyway, me and Marian, we started talking about this kind of thing, and it dawned on us that the kind of thing that I was studying at the cell line must have and should be there. There is biological logic behind it. And we were looking at it at the molecular level. There was very, very little work in the 80s, hardly anything. We had 2-3 examples at the molecular level. But when we looked at the genetic work from the beginning of the century throughout, a lot of examples for transgenerational inheritance. Nobody had a clue what the mechanisms are. Sometimes they had some clue, but not much. And there was a kind of feeling there's nothing you can do about it. With Mendelian genetics, you knew what you had to do with it. It was clear how you can go forward, what you can do, how you can develop it. It was great. You know, I am a geneticist. I love genetics, Mendelian genetics. I taught it. I mean, it's wonderful. It's elegant. It's beautiful. You know what to do. And you make very sure that you're working under conditions that you actually will see this aspect of heredity coming to the fore, not other aspects, nothing that sort of clouds it. So I think really that we are sort of at this point in the history of biology, where we're coming back to ideas that were around very much in the 1930s and elaborated in a very very interesting way. And there is a lot we can learn from it and go forward with it.
Thank you. So we have the next person here on my list is Matt Parker. So Matt, if you wanna ask your question.
Hi, yeah, thank you. Thank you for that very enlightening talk. I love seeing paradigms and thought styles shattered. I want to ask, so in early in the talk when you were outlining you were outlining the new point of view, and one of the points was that we need to think more in terms of the organism as a whole. And I was wondering why the emphasis in particular on the organism rather than on colonies, families, populations, larger groups, and can you say more about how this fits into your point of view?
Yes, well, you're right, of course. And it's not just the organism as a separate thing from the environment and from the social environment and so on. But because it is very development-centered, you know, when you're thinking, for example, let me give you an example. When you're thinking about the effect of the social environment, the family environment, for example, how much care you get as a kid. Let's say you are a little rat. And as a little rat, you can get a lot of licking and grooming by the mother, or the mother can be rather frugal with respect to this. Now, what will happen to you then? Now, there is an effect of the behavior of the mother on your nervous system. It transpires that if you get a lot of love and care and so on, and grooming and stuff for the first six days, there is a sensitive period. Then when you grow up, you will be a kind of a brave little mouse or brave little rat. You will explore the environment, you will be curious, your sexual maturation will be early and so on and so forth, right? Now, if you don't, you will be a little bit neurotic during the 6 days. Afterwards, it doesn't matter how much you get or how much you don't, right? But these 6 days are very crucial. Now, if you're a female and you got a lot of care, you will give the same style of care to your offspring, right? So if you're a female and you got a lot of care, you will care a lot for your kids. And if you are a female that got very little care, you will give very little care to your kids too. You will copy. Somehow your brain during the 6 days was sort of reorganized through this behavior in such a way that certain tendencies will come to the fore depending on the care that you got. I'm talking about you as a female because the male rats don't give a paternal care. Yeah, it's just the mom. That's why the males are irrelevant in this case. So now, why am I talking about development? So it's very much the family, right? Now, but what is interesting is that it is mediated by physiological changes. What kind of physiological changes? So people looked at the brain of this rat and they found out that there is a particular network of neurons in the brain that is related to the stress response. The changes, that genes in this network change their expression. And they change their expression in a way that is very stable and is stabilized by one of the epigenetic mechanism that I was talking about, right? By methylation. It changes the methylation pattern. So you can think about this. So this epigenetic change is sort of mediating this is the physiological change that maternal care induces. It induces a physiological change and an epigenetic change in the brain. Now, we know about other examples like this. In this case, it is not transmitted through the germline, transmitted through the reconstruction of behavior. Because during the 6 days, your brain is reorganized in a way that you will, that leads you to repeat the same maternal behavior when you are a mother, right? Now, the importance here is that suddenly we have something that changes physiologically that we can handle, that we can point to, and we can say, look, we are very interested in this. And this is a bridge that is created between the behavioral aspects, and they can be cultural aspects too, right? We know that, for example, kids who were sexually abused in a terrible way during their childhood, we know that there are epigenetic changes in their brains. Okay, they are. And the horrible things. And we know, now this is not inherit, there's not, I'm not talking about inheritance here, but I'm talking about a very long-term effect. Okay, there are all kinds of and this epigenetic changes, they are sort of a kind of bridge, biological bridge between culture, behavior, ecology, and the development of the individual organism. That's why people are talking about it, because it is such a powerful bridge, because suddenly biologists and psychologists and ecologists that were talking about very different things have this converging point. They can suddenly talk the same language. They can plan experiments together, because the psychologists will know what is stressful, what is not stressful, and how to study this kind of things. So can the anthropologists, so can the sociologists. And the biologists will have some clues about what to look at and what methodologies to look how this kind of things change the biology of the organism in a way that can be transmitted to the next generation, sometimes not. Sometimes it will just affect the individual in question for a very long time. So that's why the focus is on individual development, not because it is not recognized that individual development doesn't exist in a vacuum. Of course it doesn't.
That's amazing, thank you. I have another question, but if there's someone else waiting, I will wait.
Okay, well, I think we're gonna take one more question from the chat, and then that's gonna be it. But maybe there's a way for you to ask your question. So if you either send it to me, I can convey it to Eva afterward, or yeah, sorry. Yeah, so that's going to be our last question. So Eva, if you have access to the chat, you can also read it at the same time. So that person says that their microphone is not working. But Sergio, if you want to turn on your camera, if you have a camera, go ahead. So I'm going to try to do my best to convey here the idea of the question, which is regarding Lynn Margulis' kind of response to Darwinian criticism to Darwinism against Darwinian criticism against the Gaia hypothesis, which one of the response was that, well, we can think of those, well, the Gaia here in terms of self-organization and so on. And so the person here is asking whether you think that evolution in four dimension can be reconciled with the Gaian system that autonomous self maintain. Or that here, maybe one way to rephrase that, trying to not to make too much of a mess here, Sergio, is that how is the evolution in four dimension is compatible or not with this idea maybe that Kaufman brought up about thinking evolution in terms of self-organization?
You know, all biological systems are self-organized. I mean, nobody organizes them from the top. All biological systems are like that. So I think it is very interesting. So especially, it's true that when you're thinking about very primitive systems and you're thinking about how all these interactions happen so that the system is self-maintaining, that's very, very important for thinking about biology in general. So self-organization and the way that, I mean, autopoiesis, for example, the Maturana and Varela kind of way of thinking is very important. It's very basic, very fundamental to thinking about biology in general. And the Gaia hypothesis, the hypothesis that the planet with the life on it and so on, is a self-organizing system. You know, I don't know too much about it, but it makes a lot of sense to me. I mean, the brain too is a self-organizing system. And so, now the question is it a heredity system? Can we talk about heredity? In what sense can we talk about the evolution of this system without having multiplication? Because we don't have multiplication. Without having replication at the level of the system itself. I mean, reconstruction at the level of the whole system, not of the components of the system. How do we think about it? It's a difficult question because I don't want to say, look, we can't. A lot of people said, for example, John Maynard Smith said, look, this is not evolution, sorry. You have to have multiplying entities. I'm not so sure. The reason I'm not so sure is that I understand his point of view, but I think that, for example, when you're thinking about the brain, you can think about the brain, and let's say, let's forget for the time being about the cells that do divide in the brain. We know that there are bits in the hippocampus and the amygdala that do, that some cells in the brain replicate, but many of the cells in the brain do not replicate, okay? Do not multiply. Now, can we talk about evolution in the brain, or can't we talk about evolution of the brain? I think we can, and we can do it in the terms that Edelman suggested, or Jean-Pierre Changer suggested, through processes of selective stabilization. So if you have a lot of variability in synapses, and you have and some of them are pruned and some of them are reinforced, and you have changing patterns, and you can have cumulative patterns of change within the brain. So you can have evolution in the brain, in a sense, an evolutionary-like process in the brain that is not dependent on replication and is not dependent on, there is variation, of course, there is no replication, no multiplication, sorry, there is differential stabilization, and it can be cumulative. And it's cumulative because there is all the time a kind of pressure for retaining homeostasis within the system, so that the organism is in some kind of homeostasis and thriving and so on and so forth. Now, with the Gaia thing, I can see how different patterns of how things can reconstruct within the system, within the system. But it's difficult for me to see what is the kind of general attractor, what is the attractor of in the system. The system is self-maintaining because what? Yeah, it is just self-maintaining as such. And yes, so in this sense, if you just think about self-maintenance and improved self-maintenance, but improved compared to what? Compared to itself at time T1. Yeah, it's very difficult to think in normal evolutionary terms about it. You have to have this kind of, you have to define the kind of values that is driving the system. In living organisms, it's reproduction, survival and reproduction. Reproduction doesn't exist in the case of Gaia. Survival, you can say, does. Self-maintenance does. So you have to change the kind of value that you're thinking about. And then you can have to ask, is evolution cumulative or not cumulative? And what does it mean within this redefined system? I think these are very difficult questions. And I didn't see a terribly good analysis of this question in the terms that I'm thinking about. So it's difficult for me to answer.
Yeah, no, clearly thinking about inheritance.
I can't discount it. I mean, you know, I think there's work to do there.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Eva. Thank you, everyone, for those who came here today. Thanks for those who answered or asked questions. So we're going to end the talk here. I wish everyone a very good weekend and a very good end of the term as well.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you.